Good evening. Welcome to Minds Behind the Mind. This is the third of four in a series of presentations by researchers here at the Mind Institute. This evening, a couple of things to remind you, please. If you have cell phones, turn them to either vibrate or off. If you have pagers, likewise, please. The other thing is, on the table out front as you came in to your left, there are flyers about research studies. There are also a couple of sheets of paper where you can sign your name if you're interested in more information or either in participating in research studies. Please visit that on your way out. There is also a flyer regarding the 7th Summer Institute on Neurodevelopmental Disorders, which occurs on August 2nd and 3rd, just a couple of weeks away. If you would, and take a flyer and check out, there might be something you might find interesting there. We certainly would welcome your attendance. This evening, I am going to as well. that's your first mistake. When I said I knew that was a mistake. It is my honor to present to you a team of researchers that have come together to launch one of the major studies here at the Mind Institute, known as the Autism Phenome Project. And I will take this time to introduce you to Dr. David Amroll, who is Director of Research here at the Mind Institute and wears a host of other titles along with that title. And he will introduce the other speakers as they are presented. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Amroll.
Well, thank you, John, and thank you, everybody, for coming out this evening. We weren't sure with vacations happening whether we'd have a good audience, but we're glad that you've all come out. And what we're going to do tonight is something a little bit different than what the last two Minds Behind the Mind did, which was more sort of treatment-oriented. Tonight, we're going to tell you about some of the research, and I emphasize some because this is, even though this is a big project, this is only a small fraction of all the research that takes place at the Mind Institute. So the title of the talk tonight is Uncovering the Mysteries of Autism, and this is going to be sort of a tag team presentation. What we're going to do is each one of us is going to take about 12 minutes. I'm going to give an overview on the whole project. Robin Hansen then will talk about the experience of a family and a child going through this project. Sally Rogers will talk about some of the behavioral studies. Christine Nordahl will talk about our MRI setup. And then Judy Vandewater will talk about the studies we're doing on the immune system in this project. That should hopefully conclude in about an hour. And then we're going to have a panel session where you all will be able to ask whatever questions you'd like to ask about the science that we're in the projects that we're doing. So I guess what I'd like to do is ask you to jot down your questions and hold them till the end, and then we can have at least a half an hour of questions. So to go ahead and get started then, there's a sort of subtopic to this. It's the Autism Phenome Project, or, why is it so difficult to figure out autism? You would think with all the money now that's going into it and all the scientists who are involved, you know, we should have figured this out already. Well, it turns out, as I'm sure all you are aware, autism is a daunting disorder to understand, and we're going to tell you a little bit about why that is. So let's start with some basics. As I'm sure most of you know, the three cardinal features of autism, or the three cardinal impairments of autism, are social impairment, communication impairments, and repetitive behaviors. It's really a behaviorally defined disorder. We don't have a biological marker at the moment that tells you whether you have autism or not. It's really defined on using a variety of behavioral tests to determine whether you have impairments in these three domains. As again, you probably most of you know, it hasn't been studied for all that long. Leo Kanner first described autism in 1943, and up until about 15 or 20 years ago, there really wasn't all that much research, and partially induced by parent advocates, over the last 10 years, there's been an enormous amount of autism research that's gotten started, and it's been much more multidisciplinary. By definition, autism arises during the first 3 years of life, and there's a number of signs and symptoms that you can see prior to that. Both Sally Rogers and Sally Ozenoff are studying that intensively. The latest figures are that it occurs in 1 in 150 children in the United States and in other countries where it's been studied. It's a male-to-female ratio of 4 to 1, 4 boys to every 1 girl that has autism. And despite the fact that some behavioral therapies are effective and certainly improve the quality of life and the cognitive abilities of children with autism, typically it's thought to have, it's non-curable at the moment, and to have a chronic lifelong course. It's said to be one of the most heritable disorders. The concordance, that is, whether one, if you have monozygotic twins, if one twin has autism, whether the other twin will have it is about 85% likely, and that's one of the highest concordance rates in psychiatric conditions. But we don't have an autism gene, and what this picture shows you here is actually all the chromosomes of the human genome. And every place that you see a colored little blip on each one of these chromosomes going from 1 to 22 in the X chromosome is a place or a gene that has been implicated in autism. But the bottom line is that people think that autism is going to be a polygenic disorder. That means that there's going to be more than one gene that has to be disrupted in order to get the disorder. And the best guess is anywhere between 4 and 20 genes have to be disrupted in an individual before you get the disorder. But there's actually another possibility, and that is that we're talking about lots of different disorders, and each one of those has a different set of genes. And that theme is what we're going to try and portray to you tonight, that autism is really not a single disease, but actually multiple disorders that all have common symptoms. One indication that there's heterogeneity in autism is that there's a spectrum of severity. So people talk about individuals that have low functioning autism that have the definition of autism, but then they also have profound developmental delays, have an IQ less than 70. On the other end of the spectrum, you have people that are even given a different term, Asperger's syndrome, and these individuals can have superior cognitive abilities, superior IQ, yet they still have some of the hallmark features of autism. What are some of the other areas of heterogeneity? I could go on and on about the things that are different in one individual with autism from another, but I just came up with a couple of examples. One is onset. When do you get autism? Well, it turns out there's good evidence that some children have autism probably right from the get-go, perhaps even from conception, and maybe there's genetic causes. And that if you look at those children very early in life, there's signs and symptoms that they're just not right, that there's something abnormal in their behavior. Yet there's equally good evidence that other children, perhaps as many as 25% of children with autism, hit their developmental milestones normally for about the first 18 months, perhaps even a little bit longer than that. And that sometime between 18 and 24 months, something happens, and we're not certain of what that something is. And then they lose language function, they lose social ability, and they regress into autism. And then that autism is indistinguishable from the autism that started early on. Perhaps may even be more severe in those kids that go through regression. Another sign that is of heterogeneity is that some 30% of individuals with autism have epilepsy. Epilepsy, we know, is a disturbance of brain excitability. Yet 70% of individuals, at least the data suggests thus far, don't have epilepsy. So now you have a group of individuals who have autism plus epilepsy, two different diseases, and you have another group that has just autism. So there must be something about the biology of those two individuals. And finally, something that we are very interested in, what does the brain look like in autism? Well, it turns out even here there's heterogeneity. So about 20% of individuals with autism have big heads and big brains. They have what's called macrocephaly. However, about 15% of individuals with autism have brains that are too small. They have microcephaly. And it's unlikely that the same biology is causing both a too big brain and a too small brain. Something must be different in those individuals. So what causes autism? Well, we don't know what causes autism at the moment. But it's fairly certain that autism is a medical disorder that not only affects the brain, but other body systems. And you're going to hear from Judy Vandewater about how it disrupts the immune system tonight. But here's one of the take-home messages for this evening. There are likely to be many causes of autism and many types of autism. So more and more in the research literature, you're starting to see that people are talking about autisms, not about autism. And I think that this is really a hallmark of the future of autism research, that we're going to be looking for different causes for different individuals with the disorder. And the sort of model that we work under is that certainly there's genetic contributions to the development of autism, but there's also environmental factors. So you can actually think, and this is just sort of a cartoon for you to think about, autism type A might be purely genetically determined, and maybe those are the children that are showing autism right from the get-go, from conception. Then there's other children, autism type B, maybe they have genes that are risk factors to autism. The genes, the abnormalities, don't cause the autism itself, but then when they interact with something in the environment, whether it's a heavy metal or whatever, it causes the autism. And this would be a gene by environment interaction. And there's even the possibility, and there's some data for this, that if you have genes that wouldn't even predispose you to autism, but you interact with something in the environment, for example, thalidomide, in the old days of using thalidomide caused children with autism. Those children presumably wouldn't have had autism had they not had interaction with thalidomide. So you can have purely environmental contributions to autism. Okay, so the problem to date is that research has been too fragmentary to allow determination of the biomedical and behavioral characteristics to define the subtypes of autism. So for example, you can have one institution, one laboratory that studies the genetics, another laboratory that studies behavior, but not the genetics. You can have another laboratory that studies the brain, but not the genetics or behavior. You can have other laboratories that study the immune system. But the point is, only by studying all of these things do you see the big picture. Did anybody know that was going to be an audience? Everybody knew? God, you're good. Anyway, you get the point, right? So the autism phenotyping project that we're going to tell you about tonight is trying to get the big picture. Basically, we're bringing in a large number of children and families where each child will have a multidisciplinary analysis, and Robin Hanson will go through all the facets of this. But the important and unique and innovative aspect of this is that every child will have a medical exam, every child will have genetics evaluation, every child will have behavioral evaluation, immunological evaluation, and brain scans, and we'll take a detailed family history as well. Putting all this information together will hopefully allow us to determine the subtypes of autism. And once we have determined the subtypes of autism, then we can go after the causes of each type. It's like mixing apples and oranges and saying what's in common. Well, they're both sweet, but there's a lot of genetics that makes them different. And we need to separate the apples and oranges of autism into specific subtypes. So just a couple more facts about this. This study brings children into the program at a very early age, 2 to 3.5 years of age. We want to see autism before it's uncorrupted, in a sense, by therapies and other kinds of things that are experienced in the environment. We want to see the children over time. We want to see how the autism evolves as the children grow older. And for genetic and other kinds of studies, we want to take samples both from siblings and from parents. And here's the status. We've already started this project. We're collecting data. Last year, Last year, we wanted to make sure that everything we want, oh, that's too dark. There we go, okay. We wanted to make sure that everything we're doing in this project can be done. We know we're putting families through an enormous amount of work, and we're putting children through an enormous number of tasks. We wanted to make sure that everything is feasible. We were able to successfully bring in 40 families, 40 subjects, and I can tell you that everything that we're going to talk about tonight is feasible, is doable. The National Institute of Mental Health became a partner with the MIND Institute, and they're one of our collaborators. And hopefully, to get this done quickly, we have to generate large numbers of subjects. They're our first partner. We've been doing fundraising, and just a couple of weeks ago, we started the first full implementation year, and our goal for this year is to process through this whole program 100 families. That's incredibly ambitious when you see how much stuff we want to do with these 100 families. The success of this project, if it's going to work, it's going to be a collaboration between the MIND Institute scientists and the community. And I just wanted to end by saying that for this project, we need volunteer families, both with children with autism, but often escapes people is that we need to be able to compare children with autism with people with kids that are typically developing. And it's maybe even more difficult and more important for us to be able to recruit families that have typically developing children as well. So as we talk about this through the evening, I would like you to think about who could you encourage to come to the MIND Institute and help us with this project. So I want to then turn the podium over to Robin Hansen, our clinical director, and she's going to tell you a little bit about what the families and children experience.
Thank you, David, and thank you all for coming. So my job today is to try and walk you through what a family who was participating, whether they had a child with autism or whether they had a typically developing child, what that experience might be like, and also to try and do a broad overview of what are the different components in a little more detail that David mentioned to you just in his talk, I think. So let me start out with the medical piece. That's the one I'm the most familiar with. And this is usually when families come in, this is one of the first components of their visit. And the medical piece has a lot of overlap with another study that you might be familiar with. It's also of sorts a phenotyping project called the CHARGE study. And many of our children who are coming into the Autism Phenome Project are coming through CHARGE. So it's a subset of those children. And we've established both a way of recruiting and a lot of the assessment for confirmation of diagnosis one way or the other. So what we're trying to do in terms of the medical piece is really try and systematically collect a lot of information from multiple different sources, medical records, family history, interviews, questionnaires, and also then physical exam, neurologic exam. And one of the pieces that I think is really unique is that we're using a very fancy camera that allows us to create three-dimensional pictures that we can then look very carefully at facial structure that may reflect early changes in facial development related to early changes in brain development prior to birth. So this is a component that is a really key piece of the medical part. And the other piece, I wanted to just go back and also talk about a little bit in terms of the medical team, because I think this is one of the components, the blood draw is one of the components that I know many children look forward to the least, as do their parents, particularly fathers. For some reason, fathers, I think, sometimes are more nervous about the blood draw than their children. But you will get a chance to meet some of our team members who are part of the family, who deal with families who are coming through for the visits. And our phlebotomists have worked, and all of our team members have really focused a tremendous amount of work and a tremendous amount of effort to try and make sure that we have addressed everything that we have control over so that families experience each of these visits in the most family-friendly way that we know about. And this includes the blood draw. So we have a special chair, we have distractors, we have very well-trained phlebotomists, we have games, we have rewards, we have every reinforcement we can think of. And if any of you have participated, you know that we try and ask ahead of time, are there particular things that would be frightening to your child? Are there things that are really reassuring? Do you want to bring a videotape that is calming? Do you make sure that if there's some kind of a toy or a treasured object that would make your child feel more comfortable, that we know about it, and if there's anything that we could avoid, please let us know ahead of time. So we really do a lot of background to try and get to know families before they even walk through our doors. And we have found that that's a really important part of making this family friendly and successful. So the next component that is sort of longitudinally after the medical piece of it really is the evaluation of behavior and neuropsychology. And Dr. Sally Rogers will talk in much more detail about some of the procedures that they're using as well as some of the data that they're collecting. So I'm not going to spend any more time on that. Brain structure and function, there's a familiar face there along with Dr. Tony Simon. And Christine Nordahl will be telling you about her techniques for getting children, very young children, into the MRI scanner without using sedation. We tried very hard to come up with protocols, again, that are very family friendly, so you'll see that we have a way of convincing the children that this is a really fun thing to do, and all they have to do is go to sleep, and when they wake up, they're done. Brain function. This is a component that's led by Cliff Sarin and Susan Rivera. And as you can see, this is Dr. Rivera's daughter. And this is a way of looking at very complicated EEGs that look at the response to different kinds of sensory stimuli. It's not painful, it's kind of fun. Certainly Cliff and Susan make it as fun as it possibly could be. But we generate a lot of data about how the brain is working in response to different kinds of environmental stimulation. We also look at environmental exposures, because one of the things that, as David mentioned, we are really very interested in is what is this interaction or the potential interactions in different potential etiologies for autism that are related to triggers in the environment. I think this is something that parents worry about a lot, and we are very concerned about trying to isolate and try and identify what might be going on in their environment that's different than 20 years ago, and maybe that's contributing to the apparent increase in both the prevalence and incidence of autism. So we are collecting lots of samples. We are collecting a tremendous amount of history. We are asking families to try and go back in their memories to remember a lot of things that are in some ways very difficult, but I think we've come up with methods of trying to help remind you of something that you might have been exposed to in your child's past. Genomics and genetics, again, as David said, there have been lots of different genetic points that have raised concerns that they might be related to autism, and it seems like we need to look in a lot of different ways to try and look at the combinations of genes that may be contributing to susceptibility. And then Dr. Vandewater and Dr. Eshwood are in charge of our immunology core, and Judy's going to be talking more about some of her results. And Dr. Li Wei-jin is in charge of our specimen repository. So you can imagine if we're getting siblings and parents and individual children, we have lots and lots of samples. And so they are all distributed so that they can be analyzed appropriately, and Dr. Jin is in charge of that. So as you can tell, this requires many visits here and to the imaging center as well as to the Center for Mind and Brain. The first two visits are usually part of the CHARGE study for children who are coming through the CHARGE study and then going on to participate in the Autism Phenome Project. This is really for the children who are coming in with autism to confirm their diagnosis of autism and also to get a measure of their cognitive levels at the time that they come into the study. Then we begin with the APP piece of it. Again, I'm going to let Dr. Rogers spend more time talking about visit 3A, but I just wanted to show you a really quick video that we've put together for families, again, to try and help them know what to anticipate, to have a sense of what this might be like for their child, so that they can get their child as prepared as possible.
Hi, I'm Cynthia, one of the researchers at The Mind, and I'm here to tell you a little bit about the behavior assessment of the Autism Phenome Project. In this session, we'll study your child's thinking, language, communication, imitation, and play skills. When you come to the Mind Institute for your visit, you can go directly to the research clinic to check in. When you're done checking in, your child can play in the waiting area. Our APP Family Support Liaison will meet you in the waiting room. She'll walk you through the informed consent process and explain a bit about the study. She'll also give you a parent binder with information about the study, parent questionnaires, and other resources for you. The family liaison will go over which parent questionnaires and forms must be completed during the behavior assessment visit and which need to be finished and returned at a later date. She'll also give your child a small photo book with some of the places your child will visit and the people your child will meet during your various APP visits. You'll meet one of these people during this visit. A member of the MRI team will meet and speak with you briefly about the upcoming MRI visit. This is the first of many opportunities you will have to ask questions about the MRI session. The examiner will then greet you and your child in the waiting area. Spend a few minutes getting to know your child and go over the plan for this visit. Then it's off to the testing room. After you've helped make your child comfortable at the table, you can sit down near your child to watch the session. The assessments begin with activities that involve playing with toys and the examiner. Then there will be a few standardized tests of language and thinking skills. This involves things like looking at pictures, playing with small toys, and answering questions. We do what we can to keep the entire behavior assessment under 2 hours, but depending on the needs of the child, sessions can run longer. We offer breaks as needed, and if necessary, some assessments can be done during another visit. After the standardized testing, there is a planned break where we'll ask you to take your child for a short walk or play with your child in the waiting area. When you come back, we'll give you some time to just sit and play with your child. After this parent-child interaction, the examiner will take you back to the waiting area for several measurements. Your child's head circumference, weight, and height will be measured. Several photos of your child will also be taken at this time. After that, the APP family liaison will be ready with a basket of toys and prizes for your child to pick out something to take home. She'll also give you your compensation for the visit at this time. Before leaving, some families choose to review and confirm their upcoming scheduled appointments. If you'd like to do this, our study coordinator would be happy to meet with you. And that's all there is to the behavior assessment visit. If you have questions before this or any other visit, you can always contact the APP study coordinator or family support liaison.
So doesn't that look like fun? So here's the next visit then would be coming back to the Mind Institute to finish the sensory battery, and then another blood draw, which takes place. And then I'm going to let Dr. Christine Nordahl talk more about how the MRIs are done. And I'm just going to run through. As we said, this is done at the Center for Mind and Brain, looking at the EEG, ERP testing. And that's it. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sally Rogers, Professor of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences, who is the leader for the behavior neuropsychology component.
There we go. Hi, everybody. So the task of this team is to characterize every single thing about a child with autism that you can see or measure with your naked eye. So in about 4 hours, that's what we set out to do. We are, our colleagues include Sally Ozanoff, Carolyn McCormick and Sherry Green, Cynthia Zerhood, whom you've seen on the team, Dave Hessel, Beth Goodland-Jones, and Ann Master-George. And across all of us, we have come up with an elaborate set of tasks, which we think really are characterizing everything you can measure about a 2 or 3 year old that you can do, as I said, just by watching, videotaping, or looking at behavior. Because autism affects everything. You know, it's a pervasive disorder. You know that there are these main symptoms, but you also know autism affects play, and autism affects imitation. Autism affects your cognitive ability, and autism affects your motor ability. Autism affects your sensory functioning. Autism affects your temperament. There is no aspect of autism, there's no aspect of a child's behavior that is not affected by this disorder. And these differ very much from one child to the next. So as we're trying to find these smaller groups that are more uniform in their characteristics, as Dr. Amaral talked about, we can't just look at the autism symptoms. We have to look at everything, because all of these things are affected. So we've tried to think about, what is it that characterizes a young child? How do you look at all of a young child's abilities and try to be able to draw a picture of this child in all of their ability areas, and so that you can look for clusters of children who are similar and clusters who are different in some ways and similar in others. So the areas that we're trying to look at, first of all, are the autism symptoms, which you see clustered up there on the corner on the left. And we have 8 different measures, including observations that we make, parent interviews and questionnaires that we get, and interactive videotapes that we take to look at children's repetitive behaviors, their communicative behaviors, their social behaviors, and the aspects of them that define autism, the core symptoms. In addition to that, we want to look at their cognitive abilities or their learning rates. As you know, this varies drastically from one child to another, and it's part of what makes autism so unique. And so we carefully measure children's learning rates, their past learning rates, using developmental tools. We look at their ability to function in their own environment. How are they doing at home and out in the community in terms of the typical demands of a two or three-year-old to feed themselves, to learn about pottying, to play with other children? Children with autism vary tremendously in these abilities, even at age 2 and 3. We look in great detail at their language function, and Dr. Ann Master George is in charge of the language battery. She's a speech and language pathologist as well as a psychologist. We look carefully at joint attention skills, which are part of the nonverbal repertoire, as well as play and imitation. We look at gross motor and fine motor functioning and sensory reactivities and muscle tone. We look at children's emotional responses to other people and to loud noises and to things that surprise them and to things that they enjoy. Some children are scared of everything. Some children are incredibly relaxed about whatever it is you toss their way. And those children's brains and chemistry systems are probably quite different, those two. And we look at children's temperament, sleeping patterns, eating patterns, and things like that. So we accomplish all that in the 2 visits that Robin was just talking about. And many of these have standardized measures that we can use. And that's a big help to us, because we can characterize children relatively quickly and compare them to other children. But you know, one huge area of autism behavior is not well characterized right now. We don't have good tools for it. People have really ignored it, and yet we know it's a big part of autism, and that's the sensory area. We have very few standardized measures of sensory function, and the only ones that we have right now are based on parent report, which is, of course, an incredibly useful source of information. But a parent report, parents can tell you what they've seen, but they can't tell you how a child responds compared to one another in a standard situation. And so we really want to understand this aspect of behavior. This is important and very understudied. So we have a project going on within the APP project to really look carefully at sensory behavior. We want to understand whether sensory behavior is related to repetitive behaviors, as many people think, and whether it's related to difficult behaviors, as many people think. We want to know whether the children's behavior symptoms reflect their underlying physiology and their reactions to things that happen to them, around them in their environments. We want to understand whether their sensory responses and their sensory behaviors are linked to their social behaviors and influence how they interact with people on a day-to-day basis. And then we want to see whether children with autism really cluster in different subgroups in the area of their sensory responses. And so we're really trying to look very carefully. This is probably the most comprehensive study of sensory function in young children that's been done. And we're looking at a number of areas. We're looking at their actual bodily reactions to sensory challenges. So we wire the children up to give us information about their heart rates and their breathing rates and their skin conductance. And we repeat a set of loud noises as they're sitting in a room. And we show them spinning things. And they feel a light touch on their skin. And they get these in a fairly strong dosage, repeated one after the other. We want to see how their bodies respond the first time and whether they habituate, as most people do over time. Because as you probably know, many people think that children with autism don't habituate well, that they are overly strong in their reactions, overly sensitive, and they don't know how to tune these sensations out. But you know, there's very little data to support that right now, so we're trying to really produce the data that will answer those questions. We're also looking at their emotional reactions to these noises and non-social stimuli and to social stimuli, to both strangers and to their familiar people, doing both social things and object things. So we're comparing all that live data to their responses to the sensory questionnaires, the behavior questionnaires, and the repetitive behavior questionnaires that their parents are giving us. So we're really trying to fit together what we can observe and what we can measure with what the parents can see on a day-to-day basis. And it's been quite interesting to us, you know, nobody's ever wired up these young kids to look at their physiology, and that was one of the things we decided, we can do this, children will let us do this. And so we learned, first of all, to put the leads on their feet instead of their fingers. Your feet have the same kind of sweat glands as your hands do, and while usually with adults you would take these measures of sweat response from a finger, we thought, well, we bet we could get it from a foot. And so what the young child has to experience is getting a lead on their bare foot, a tape with an electrode attached to it and then attached to a computer, and several more electrodes on their rib cage against their skin and on their backs. We can put it on their backs instead of their chest to pick up their heart rate because they're so little. So we worked to figure out how smoothly we could do this, and you're going to see a two-year-old get completely wired up on this video so you can see how aversive this is. This is Dr. David Hessel, who's in charge of the sensory lab, and he's going to be working with this little guy who has autism, and right now he's going to be working with the foot. So you're going to see him put a lead on the foot, then you're going to see him put a lead on the child's back, then you're going to see him put a lead on the child's side underneath his shirt and attach it all and leave. And this little guy has just walked into a darkened room where a favorite video is playing on the screen. He sat in this chair before. This is where he got his testing the day before. So he knows the room, he knows the table, and he knows the setup. He zips right in. He's right up there in the chair. The video's going, and the room's dark. So he doesn't see a whole lot about what's going on. And if I can figure out how to run David's...
The
button in the front. Okay, so here goes the lead on his bare foot, and then a slipper's going to go over it, and the wire's going to get attached. There, it's on. His mother's in the back of the room. There goes the lead on his back against his bare skin. What's happening to me? And here goes the lead on his ribs, on the side, on skin. And it's done. It took 3 minutes. So this, we felt very happy about being able to do this. And all of the children have been able to participate in this. I think only one child out of the 40 that we have seen could not tolerate the leads. So. We feel like we have really learned a great deal from this. We're also going to show you some of the sensory stimuli here so you can get a sense of what the kids are looking at. So this is a challenge. This is oil of wintergreen under his nose. It's a pretty strong smell. And there's another, the same little guy. So their faces are reacting. They're telling us what they experienced. There's a strobe light. Wow. It's loud as a siren, 90 decibels. So not only can we read and code their faces and their body reactions, but remember, we have these electrodes that are feeding data, and we can look at all their heart rate, their respiration rate, and their arousal measures. So we have seen a number of children at this point, both typical and typically developing in children with autism. And the data that we have right now, I just want to point out, I'm almost finished here, if I can figure out how to work this. Okay, so this is the kind of data that we get from these sensory challenges. This is the 90 decibel siren that goes off 4 times in a row. And each of these lines shows you the group as a whole, their reactions to each repetition. So this is the group with autism. This is how they reacted to the first repetition, the second one, the third one, the fourth one. And this is the group with typical development, the first, the second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth, there are 5 repetitions of the siren. So the first thing we see is that for the children with autism, it's dropping. The dot in the middle is the mean or the average of the groups. And we see with each repetition, the response is going down. What does that mean? It means they're habituating to this 90 decibel siren, that their body is reacting less with every repetition, which is about 5 seconds. That means they are habituating to it. And the typically developing children actually don't show as much habituation as the children with autism. So that's one thing that's important here. And we're seeing this consistently. There is habituation. Our sample is showing it, and studies of adults have shown it. The second thing that this shows us is, look at the first response. The children with autism's first response is up here at this level. The typically developing children's first response is down here. This says that the children with autism are responding more strongly to the first stimulus with their bodies. They're reacting more strongly than are the typically developing children who are the same age. But after the first response, we see a fairly similar mean response to the rest of these. So this shows that, in fact, the children with autism are responding more strongly to the first sound than the comparison group is, but they are accommodating to the sound. And this is important news for both teachers and therapists and families in terms of the expectation that children can get used to sensory stimuli that are bothering them if we can help them deal with habituation. So that's all I wanted to talk about, really, just to share with you the kinds of things we're looking at in the behavior group and the neuropsychology group, and also how we're going in depth into the just one area, the sensory area, using the most sophisticated techniques that we have, and also learning all that we using all the knowledge we've developed about young children with autism and their families to figure out how to ask the children questions in a way they can answer us. How does this feel to you? These tools allow the children to tell us how it feels to them and lets us test some of our hypotheses. So thank you very much. I'm happy to have a chance to share with you. And now I will be able to introduce Dr. Christine Nordahl, who will be talking with you about the brain imaging data. Thank you.
So I want to talk to you a little bit about what we're doing with the MRI part of the Autism Phenome Project. And we're basically analyzing the structure of the brain. So first of all, structural neuroimaging is a really important tool in trying to understand what's going on, the underlying brain abnormalities that are associated with autism. Structural MRIs give us a very detailed picture of the brain in vivo, and it has the added benefit of being very safe and relatively non-invasive. And I'll talk about that relatively part later on. Over the past couple of decades, there have been a number of studies using MRI to look at autism. And we have learned quite a bit from these studies. One of the approaches has been to look for specific structures that may be affected in autism. And the approach here is to look at brain regions that may be associated, based on what we know about their normal function, brain regions that are associated with each of the behavioral deficits in autism, and then to go in and look at the structural MRIs to analyze whether any of these regions show any abnormalities. Now, certainly not all of these regions show abnormalities, but we have learned from MRI studies that certain structures do seem to be different in autism, in particular the amygdala, which is this region right here in blue. It's a region known to be involved in emotional processing and particularly in fear behaviors. And we know that this region is enlarged in very young children with autism. In fact, it gets too big too fast early on, and then as time goes on, by the time you reach adolescence, it seems to be about the same volume as typically developing controls. Going along with that, another major finding that's come out of structural MRI studies of autism is that not only are specific structures like the amygdala affected and have different patterns of growth over time, but in fact, the total brain has an altered trajectory of growth. And here I'm just showing you some pictures of the total brain as well as the gray matter, which is the outer surface of the brain. It's the part of the brain where all of the neurons or the brain cells are, and the underlying white matter, which is the part where all of the fibers or axons are connecting one part of the cortex to another. It's basically how the brain is wired and how parts of the brain talk to each other. And what we know from structural MRI studies over the past two decades is that, and the blue line here is showing what happens in typically developing brains from birth up until 25 years of age. Now, one important thing is that in MRI studies, we haven't yet gone down to birth to get MRIs. The very youngest children with autism who have been studied are at 18 months. And the vast majority of structural MRI studies that have been done in autism are actually in adolescents and adults. But there have been a few studies of early development. And what we know is that the total brain seems to undergo this early precocious period of growth. And that is, it's growing at a much more rapid rate, or a more rapid rate than typically developing controls. In fact, at age 5, there's about a 10% difference between an autistic brain and a typically developing brain. But over time, this difference seems to diminish. The gray matter, which again is where all of the neurons are, seems to have a relatively consistent enlargement over time. And the exact numbers aren't known, but the best approximate that we can guess is a 6% difference. When we look at the white matter, which again is how the areas of the brain, how the brain is talking to other parts of the brain, seems to show the largest difference early on. And this is really important because our brains are changing over time, they're developing, and the connections are actually being developed into early childhood and even into adolescence. And so what this is telling us is that very early on, the brain is just getting wired up in a different way. The parts of the brain aren't talking to each other and saying the right things, or the right messages aren't getting across. Some of the new directions that structural MRI is allowing us are to look more in depth at the structure of the white matter. And part of the Autism Phenome Project structural MRI component is to collect these relatively new types of scans called diffusion tensor imaging. And this is allowing us to look at the directionality of the fibers as well as the integrity of the fibers of the brain within the white matter. So we can actually look at fibers of one part of the brain, say the frontal lobes and the parietal lobes, and see how intact those fiber tracks are between those two regions of the brain. Another thing that we will want to be doing is a new type of analysis that we can do on a regular old MRI scan, looking at the cortical shape. So this is the pattern of the folds on the surface of the brain. It's the gyri and the sulci. And we can actually evaluate by taking the surface of the brain and turning it into what's called a sulcal depth map. And we can look for differences in the overall cortical shape. And what we think this is telling us is, again, about the connectivity. Because your brain starts out as a flat surface, but as it's getting connected up, as those wires are going from one part of the brain to another part of the brain, it's actually exerting a tension and causing the cortex to fold up. So when we look at cortical shape, we think it's also telling us something about how the connectivity is going wrong in the brain. So where do we need to go with structural MRI? Well, as I said, there have been probably close to 100 studies now done using MRI in autism. This is dating back to the late 80s, early 90s. However, out of all of those, there have been a handful, maybe 3 or 4 studies that have actually examined children who are under the age of 5. And of course, this is a period that's really important in studying autism because it's the time when the symptoms are developing and it's the time when the diagnosis is made. There are reasons why it's challenging to acquire scans in very young children, and I'll talk about that. But some of the other limitations are that the previous studies have, the largest sample sizes have been about 50 or 60 individuals. And as David was talking about, autism is incredibly heterogeneous, and we need much larger sample sizes in order to start looking at the brain. And finally, we also want to look at longitudinal design, so we want to follow the same child over time, and we want to have high-quality MRI scans. So now let me talk to you a little bit about how we actually do that. I don't know how many of you have had an MRI scan, but if you have, this is what a scanner looks like. This is actually the one that we use. And you lie down on this bed, and you go into the tube, and you have to lie incredibly still for 30 minutes to an hour. All the while, the magnet is making these really loud, obnoxious, banging noises. So how are you going to get a 2-year-old to do this? Well, the handful of previous studies have used sedation to acquire these scans, and that's actually a very safe procedure. But we wanted to try to develop a protocol to acquire these scans during natural sleep. We thought that maybe it would encourage more parents to participate if we could offer this as an alternative. So with the team, we have several steps involved in the MRI. First, introductory materials, the photo storybook is sent out, a general handout is given to the parents, and then the MRI preparation begins at the first visit. I go down, I meet with a parent, and I start talking to them about their child's sleep habits and their bedtime rituals, and we start talking about how we can make it work for us. Our team is extremely flexible. We're scanning at midnight, we're scanning at 9 o'clock, it depends on your child's bedtime. We also try to take into account, you know, what makes them comfortable. Do they watch a movie before they go to bed? Do they snuggle with their mom? And we try to let them do all of that at the Imaging Research Center. We also give them a habituation kit to practice with at home, and this is some earplugs and some headphones, as well as a CD of the actual MRI sounds. And the parent can practice placing these earplugs and headphones on their sleeping child in the comfort of the child's own bed and home to get them used to wearing that so that when we come to the MRI scan, we can get it on and go through. We have a mock MRI session that gets the child familiar with the MRI environment, and this is set up during the day. The child is awake, but we want to give them a chance to get to know us, the researchers, as well as the environment. So we have it set up in a train theme, which is very appropriate, and the child actually gets up and rides on the table, goes into the tunnel, usually has a ball doing this. And then on the night of the actual MRI scan, we have the scanner room set up not to look like this, but to look like this. And so we've hung up fabric over the scary medical things over here. We cover up the bore of the magnet so the child can't look back and say, I'm going in there. We widen the bed and make it nice and comfortable with memory foam so the kids can get up there. The bed is wide enough so both parents can get up there and snuggle with the child to let them fall asleep. The child can bring in their own blankets and stuffed animals and pillows if it makes them comfortable, but we also have some. We also have a weighted blanket for the child that helps keep them still during the scanning. So all of this happens before, you know, the child arrives. When the child arrives, the key is patience. We just have to wait. We have no control over when the child is going to fall asleep. And usually we can wait them out. They do eventually fall asleep. You know, little kids play hard and they crash hard too. So we wait till they fall asleep, and usually we can get through the whole scan. The scan takes about 30 minutes to complete, but we have a prioritized sequence of scans. So we're actually taking multiple pictures in that one MRI session, and we prioritize them so that we have our most important ones first, so that if the child wakes up, we have those, and the rest we're just being greedy and we'd like to get those, but they're not absolutely essential. And finally, we often give the parents a little tour of their child's brain after the scanning session while the child is still sleeping. But we also send them a CD of the scan so that they can see it at home, they can take it to their doctors, and we send little snapshots because the kids often like to put them up on the fridge or take them to show and tell to show their friends. And amazingly, we've had a lot of success. When we started this project, we were told by other colleagues that we would have about a 60% rate of success, that 2 to 4-year-old kids were the absolute hardest group of kids to get through an MRI without sedation. Well, so far we have a 93% success rate. We've only had 2 little guys that we couldn't get through this protocol. We get amazingly high quality images, and that's really important because we don't want blurry images because that affects all of our later analyses. Now, having said all of this, we do actually still offer sedation as an option. because we know that some parents are comfortable with that and some kids aren't going to be able to go through this protocol. But what we're really focusing on is that this is possible. We've been doing it. It's been a lot of fun. And we're hoping to get the 100 kids in the next year and a lot of late nights. So that's it for the MRI. I'll be happy to answer any questions later. You can always call me and start talking to me about your child if you want to. But now I want to introduce Dr. Judy Vanderwater, who's going to be talking about the immune component.
Hi. Well, I'm the last speaker, and I think probably have the lead people that wonder, why are we studying the immune system? What on earth does the immune system have to do with autism? And I think I'm really lucky that I didn't get the tail end of that picture on the elephant that I think it was the tusk that he gave me. But I think for us, this is a very fascinating area. I come from a background of working in autoimmune disease. So immune dysfunction is the area that I began working before I got into autism. And I think hopefully I can provide you with some of the information that we've gotten, a little bit of the information we've gotten so far, to show you some of the links that we find between the immune system and behavior and its potential role in autism. So I'm sure everyone in this room knows, has heard of the immune system, but its job really is to fight infection, to fight bacteria, viruses. That's its primary role, and that's its most familiar role, and that's what it was designed to do. Now, because my background is in autoimmunity, sometimes the immune system goes wrong, and when that happens, sometimes we make antibodies to our own proteins, and that's called autoimmunity. And sometimes the immune system isn't as functional, and it doesn't make the response it's supposed to, and that's when we have somewhat of a failure to make an immune response, and those are people who get sick very easily or who don't clear an infection. They might get a bacterial infection and it just goes on and on and on because their immune system isn't quite up to the task. So those are measures that we can use. One of the areas that we work on is how healthy is the immune system in these kids. And a healthy immune system is definitely, it's necessary for health, but the other thing that the immune system plays a role in is neurodevelopment. And I think that is something that a lot of people didn't really know until probably the last 5-10 years is how strongly integrated the immune system is with the neural system. So there's ongoing communication between these two systems, and this occurs throughout life. This isn't just when the two systems are developing, because they develop somewhat simultaneously, but throughout life, there is communication. When you get a fever and all you want to do is sleep, one of the reasons for that is because of two cytokines that are produced by your immune cells that are firing the infection that gave you that fever. And that goes to the brain, and it's a sleep signal, and those are IL-1 and TNF. So both of those cytokines are necessary for healthy sleep. And when they're increased, that makes you even sleepier. So what we've done is examined several areas of the immune system. I'm going to just talk about a couple of the ones that we're doing here, but I'm afraid we're the reason that we have that blood draw, because we do get blood from the kids and we bring the blood into the lab where we use every single bit of it. It's very precious to us. We have two freezers now full of blood that we've gotten from our CHARGE study, but we use every little bit of it. And one of the things that we look at in the system are immunoglobulin levels. And those are, your immunoglobulins are the antibodies you produce to fight an infection. And we also, so we look at levels of immunoglobulin because that tells us how robust the immune system is, how well it's functioning. If your immunoglobulin levels are very low, that means you probably aren't going to mount a very effective immune response. We also look at T cells and how well they function. So we take the immune system apart piece by piece and examine all those pieces to see if we can see where the problems are occurring. Now, probably many of you have seen in the literature now that they're saying that there are immune defects in kids with autism, but you'll see that immunoglobulins are up, they're down, they're normal. It's all over the place. I think one of the reasons for that is because age plays a great part in what your immunoglobulin levels are. If you take kids that are 2, you cannot compare them to children who are 10. One of the best aspects of the other study that many of us are involved in, the CHARGE study, is we have a very narrow range, and we only compare age-matched children. So I'm not going to compare the immune system of a normal 10-year-old to the immune system of an autistic 2-year-old, because that is not going to give me useful data. But the other thing that we're looking at also is autoantibodies. These are antibodies to self-proteins. And we're doing this both in children and in the mothers, because the mothers during gestation or during pregnancy, your immune system is your developing fetus's immune system. They don't have their own, so during that time, you have transfer from the mother through the umbilical cord into the fetus, and that is what protects that fetus from anything that the mother's exposed to. And that is healthy, normal, that is exactly what's supposed to happen. Excuse me, however, if that mother has an autoantibody to anything in that fetal tissue, that is not a good thing. And we are looking at this in autism, but we also know from the literature that in diseases such as systemic lupus, another autoimmune disease, this does have effects on the fetus and on the newborn. Excuse me, I got a cold this morning. So we do know that, oh, thanks, I know. This is because I have an 8-year-old and he just brings me everything that he comes in contact with. So thank you, Trevor. So that is one of the reasons that we're studying the maternal immune system. Another study I'm involved in, we're actually looking at the maternal immune system during pregnancy. So these are all factors that we look at. We're looking at every piece of data that we can come up with of what is going on during the development of this child with respect to the mother as well. So what do we see in the kids? Well, in our large cohort, we actually see reduced levels of antibodies in these kids. And they're not reduced to the point of what we would call agamma globinemic or no immunoglobulin, although we did have a couple that came up that low that we then contacted the families. However, they are lower than the controls. They're down at the very bottom of what we call normal. And so the other thing that we did is now, this is where we integrate our data into what we do in the behavioral aspect. So we look at what is the behavior of these kids with respect to their immunoglobulin levels. And what we found was actually the lower their immunoglobulin levels, the worse their score was on the aberrant behavior checklist. So this is an ABC score. This does not mean that having low immunoglobulins causes this bad behavior, but I think, and this is one of the things we're investigating, is whether or not the cell information network that tells the cells to make immunoglobulin, is there a similar network involved in the brain that is also defective? And so that's more what it tells us. We may have two very similar systems that act differently in each of these, but that are both defective. The other thing that we found in these kids is that we have seen antibodies to brain in about 46% of the kids. And these, you can see, these are this is the cerebellum, and these are Golgi cells that have this is a monkey brain, and when we put antibody, we put plasma that we get onto this section, and we react it with a substrate, we see this very, very specific staining pattern. As a matter of fact, we've had two kids come through that one was a sibling of a child with autism, and the other was supposed to be a typically developing control, and it turns out, and both were positive, and it turns out both, they were both supposed to be controls. One was a sibling of an autistic child that also had this pattern, and one was actually turned out to be a child with ASD, with a broader spectrum of autism. So for us, this is turning out to be a very specific response that we're getting. Now, we also are now trying to determine if these antibodies have an effect. We don't know what they do. We know that they bind these cells. We don't know what other cells they bind. And so it'll take us some time, but we will work through if these actually do have an effect on the neural tissue. Do these cause some of those changes we see, as Christine was talking about, in the connectivity? I have no idea at this point. So the role of maternal antibodies in autism, in addition to looking at the immune system of the children, as I said, we were looking at the maternal immune system, and we have found in about 21% of the mothers that we've tested a specific set of antibodies that are specific for fetal brain proteins, and this we do this by a Western blot. So we take blood from the moms and react it to these fetal brain proteins that we've run in a gel. And these antibodies occur out of the 7 that we found, let's say in a cohort of 60 moms, 6 of those moms had children with regression. So this was extremely specific for the regressive form. Now, that's not to say that all moms have this, nor do all moms with children with regression have these antibodies. But if these moms had antibodies, they were more likely to have a child with regression. And this is just a big picture. This is what we do. This is, in a nutshell, this is sort of combining all of the aspects of what we're doing. The immune development, how it affects the functional immune system, how this affects, it is normal for the immune system to help prepare the brain when something happens. And if that doesn't happen correctly, then you won't repair the brain. It is also possible that it could change neurodevelopment by affecting neural damage. The maternal influence, genetics are huge here. We can't have, I mean, the immune system is a genetically driven system, just like everything else is. And what are the exposures? Do exposures have any, play a role in this? And these are all things that we're looking at. And we have a very large team of people doing this. So I just wanted to close with that because this sort of embodies what we're doing and how these systems all are related to each other and the potential effects that changing any one of these systems may have. And did I make it? she's over there timing me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, so you've gotten a little glimpse of what the Autism Phenome Project is all about. You can imagine once a child and family goes through this project, we're gonna have enormous amounts of data. And then, part of the hard job will be to figure out how does this data actually lead to these different subtypes. And you might actually think, for example, that some kids will have abnormal brain structure and we'll see that some of their genes are dysregulated. And maybe they're the early onset types of autism, whereas other kids and mothers perhaps have immune dysregulation, but their brain looks pretty normal. And maybe those are the kids who have the regressive form of autism. We don't know yet. We have to gather the data. And I just wanted to summarize to this point by saying that there are very few places in the world that could pull this off. We built the Mind Institute to be able to do this. We have a team, I mean, there are very few places in the world where you have a team of developmental pediatricians, the foremost developmental psychologists in the world, immunologists, geneticists, brain imagers, and they're all here at the Mind Institute trying to solve this problem. So. I think you'll be hearing a lot more about the results of the Phenome Project as we gather more data. But you've heard now pretty much about the scientists, the scientific team, and not even all of them, but there's another team that are incredibly important for carrying out this project. And I wanted to introduce our project manager, Luann Barnett, here. And she will briefly introduce the rest of the, what she calls the implementation team. So, you, Luann.
So this is the team that actually makes all of this work. And it's a lot of work to interact with our families, and we love doing it. I'd like to introduce to you the APP team. Would you guys like to stand up? If you're on the APP team, come on. There we go. So I have, no, stand it. So Megan Thompson, she's helping us with our recruitment and scheduling. We have Carolyn McCormick, who is doing both behavior. She's doing MRI. She's doing a number of things. Cherie Green, who is also working on the MRI and behavior groups and sensory. And we have Dr. Cynthia Zierhut, who is our licensed clinical psychologist who does the assessments for us and really makes sure that the quality is there in the work that we do. Thank you. And Susan Rumberg, who is our family support liaison. So she works directly with the families and helps support them throughout this whole process. And then in the back, we have Lisa Cochran, who also is recruiting and scheduling and has been doing some blood specimen processing for us. So have I missed anyone? Ron? Ron Rivera at the very back is our newest member to the team, and he's our phlebotomist. So he's gonna help with that blood collection. So that's the team.
Okay, well, that's our presentation. I just want to say one final thing about the presentation, and that is that we're doing this because we want to subdivide the different types of autism into more manageable groups, and then we're going to go after the causes or the preventions of each one of those groups. That's going to make our job of doing the research a lot easier. But it's also going to make, ultimately, the treatment of children with autism easier as well, because we're going to, these same kids who will participate in the CHARGE study and the Autism Phenome Project study will be recruited into various kinds of treatment trials. And ultimately, in the fullness of time, we know that some of those kids are going to respond to a particular treatment, but others are not. And if we can work back from those that respond and see what, you know, the biological factors are that lead to that response, in the future, as a family comes in with a child that receives a new diagnosis of autism, we can say, you know, this is just not a child with autism, but this is autism type B. And you know what? The best treatment for autism type B is such and such. And we have a window of opportunity. We don't have time to mess around with all kinds of various trials. Or we have to at the moment because we can't actually put the child into the best possible treatment. But there'll be more treatments coming available. And with this kind of specificity, we'll be able to have our clinicians pick the right treatment for the right child. It's called personalized medicine, and it's the prospect for the future. But we're trying to apply that to autism here at the Mind Institute. So I want to bring this portion to a close. I'm going to ask our speakers to come back up and sit down. And basically, the audience, you can ask any question that you'd like to ask about either the Phenome Project, or you have a panel of experts here on various aspects of autism and the science. Feel free to ask whatever you like. And we just need 1 second for our, oh, wow, that's quick. All right, let's start right over here. And please just tell me who you would like. You can use the microphone there so that everybody, there's one microphone in the middle. If you speak loud, you can speak from any place, but if you have a soft voice, come up to the microphone.
Yes, I'm actually an adult with autism, and I'm very glad to hear that research is being done on the sensory issue that has been so long overlooked. Because I'm convinced that sensory discomfort has really underlain a lot of my sufferings with autism, and just the impact of all sorts of stimuli on my sensorium 24/7, 365 pretty well wears me out. And I'm glad that someone mentioned the amygdala, because what I feel is a constant sense of physiological arousal, like you say. So it's like my fight or flight mechanism is on all the time. And I just am curious what impact that could be having. I particularly struggle with GI symptoms. And I've heard about what they call the enteric nervous system, which is gastrointestinal nervous system that is impacted by your stress levels. So I just wondered if any of you that would like to comment on those issues, please do.
The GI stuff. Okay, so we don't have a mic.
That's my
oh, we do, okay. So I'll start with the GI, I guess sort of the GI question or issue. And the GI system is highly innervated, so it's very well wired, and there's a lot of connections. Just like with the immune system, it's also very tied in with the immune system. So I guess it's not a surprise that all of these systems have to function together. And so when one system is kind of out of whack or dysfunctional, then it's has a propensity to affect multiple other systems. So we have, I mean, one of the areas that we'll be looking at, that we're looking at in CHARGE study and that we're looking at in APP, is how do parents describe their child's current GI symptoms, their history of GI symptoms, and how do we relate that to what we find in blood as a measure of the immune system function. We will be able to relate it to what's their sensory responsivity? Is that correlated with symptoms like chronic GI problems? So I don't know that we don't have any answers, but certainly that's a question that we can ask and that we plan to look at.
Anybody else on the panel? I'll just say one more thing about that. I think it's incredibly interesting. It's when you start having neuroscientists and immunologists and, you know, clinicians working together, you start thinking in unique ways. Turns out that the amygdala which is probably in our brains to look for dangers in the environment. And it's only supposed to be turned on every once in a while. But in some people that have anxiety disorders, it actually is going all the time. And in animal studies, what that's shown is that if you turn on your amygdala all the time, you get stomach ulcers. Because the amygdala directly drives gastric secretions in the gut. So the fact that we've seen abnormalities in the amygdala in kids with autism and GI problems are actually another prominent symptom, nobody's been able to tie the two together. It's only when you actually gather all this data that you can tie those two things together. But I'm certain that, you know, within the foreseeable future, people are going to be able to explain the kinds of things that you're experiencing. So thanks for your comments. Other questions? Let me go to this side, and I'll try and go back and forth. Yeah.
Real quickly, is the head size macro or micro at the presentation at all predictive of ultimate cognitive outcome, the high functioning versus low functioning autistic child?
Well, small head circumference is much more likely to be associated with low function.
Across the board.
Across the board, regardless. Big sizes or macrocephaly can be either way. So it's not necessarily one way or the other.
And one of your exceptional lecture series that I've been attending for about 3 years, you had a speaker that talked about how the second child born in a family often was more impacted, regardless of whether it was a girl or a boy. And one of the thoughts was whether or not this might be like the Rh iso immune phenomenon that we see.
I mean, that is. I think what we call the multiplex families are the ones who are more likely to potentially fall into our category of the autoantibodies in the moms. I mean, that would certainly fit. If I were to say to model it, that's what I would say. That if you had one child with autism and you had those antibodies, that your second child would be predicted to have at least be impaired or affected. And we're currently doing this study to see if that is actually the case.
I was just going to say, in terms of the small head predicting more impairment, it's a really small head, though.
Right.
It's not just kind of smaller.
Microcephaly. Right.
Does it matter if it's congenital or acquired microcephaly?
Yeah, there really hasn't been enough work on that to really know. I think you've heard is correct. There's also a big chunk in the middle. We're talking about 20% and 15%. And those the kids in the middle, we haven't actually characterized their brain structure well enough to know whether they have maybe specific abnormalities of the amygdala, the frontal lobe, the cerebellum that actually correlates, or the basal ganglia, which is known to be involved in OCD-like behavior as well. Is the stereotypies that you see in kids more related to a bad basal ganglia? The problem up until now, as I said early on, was that nobody has tried to look at the children and see what their behavior is, and at the same time do a comprehensive study like Christine told us about of their brains. We're hoping that the kinds of questions that you're asking are going to come out of the data we're going to gather. Yeah.
Since all infants get an otoacoustic emission test or some sort of basic hearing screen at birth, and we know the newborn siblings of autistic children have a greater risk, and we're finding these sensory differences with greater habituation. I'm wondering if there's, like in the marble study, as the younger siblings, the high-risk babies are studied, if that kind of sensory processing is going to be looked at in the marble study.
We'll be able to look at newborn hearing screening because we're hoping that all of the babies will get that, and we could go back and look at that. At this point in time, we don't have that in the sort of the behavioral assessment piece that we're doing, but
it might be fairly easy to do.
There are certain things that we could certainly do depending on what we find.
Yeah, I think we'd first want to know that it's characterized as autism and is specific, and second, that it's a risk marker for children with autism. And then if we find out that that's a risk marker, then you're right, we've got a built-in methodology to try to screen high-risk samples. That's a nice idea, Linda.
Thank you.
There's a sort of a practical problem with doing these kinds of big studies. And the practical problem is that they're very expensive. So as you can imagine, What we can do in the autism, in the charge in the Autism Phenome Project, is get a large number of children that already have a diagnosis. And we can then do this comprehensive workup and start looking at factors that correlate. But as the question addresses, we're not actually looking at kids even younger. And we don't look at kids that are even younger because we don't have a foolproof diagnosis. So if we did everything that we needed to do on, say, newborns, right? So it cost about $20,000 to do this comprehensive workup that we're doing in the APP. But even in high-risk newborns, the probability that a child's going to have autism is maybe 10%. So for every 10 that you do the comprehensive workup, you're only going to get one child with autism. Now, for that data, it's spectacular. But the Marble study is trying to take a more limited view because it's just pragmatically difficult to do. If we, for example, could have a biological marker, a blood test for autism, then you'd want to do all of these other things. But it's these are the kind of decisions you have to make when you're planning these projects. Other question? Yeah. Sorry.
We just relocated from the Los Angeles area, and I have an 11-year-old high-functioning autistic son. While the kid is still in school, I'm just curious, how could we accelerate in participating in the Autism Phenome program if my son be qualified in the project? I mean, while he's still out of school, I would like him to be a part of it. I mean, what would be the easy way?
Yeah. Well, again, this is really hard too. So our criteria for this particular project is that the child has to be in that age range between 2 and 3.5. However, there are huge numbers of other projects going on at the Mind Institute, and what I would recommend is, since you're new to the area, that you check our website or there's information out there, and get involved in some of our other projects. And many of our other projects are looking at certain features that are in the Autism Phenome Project, you know, maybe not packaged in exactly the same way. And this question came up again early on, you know, should we be looking at kids at all ages? And we would love to be looking at kids at all ages. But again, it's sort of a practical approach. When you have a child that's 11, your child has had autism for a long time. The brain has adapted to autism for a long time. It's been probably various therapies that have changed all of his behavior for a long time. So in a sense, to look at what is pure autism, you want to try and have the youngest possible kid. That's not to say that there are a lot of other studies where a child that's 11 would be perfectly appropriate. So that we struggled with this early on because there's some things that obviously we cannot do in a child that's 2 or 2.5 years old. There's another kind of MRI called functional MRI where you can actually look at the brain working. And you can give the child stimulation, visual stimulation, you can give them pictures, faces, and you can actually look at what part of the brain is active when they're perceiving those faces. You can't do that with a 2-year-old because they're just not going to pay attention to the task. That's something that you can do with an 11-year-old, and there are several studies going on with functional imaging at the moment of children with autism. So again, I recommend that you get your child involved in some of these other studies. Sally?
Since you're new to the area, you may not know that we have a database here at the Mind Institute. If families want to be participating in the studies of the Mind Institute, you can choose to have the information about your child in our central research participant database. And if you're in that database, then anytime we mount a study that says we need boys from age 8 to 12 with higher in the higher IQ range, then you would be called and you'd be notified for any study in which your child would fit into the description. And then you can choose, do I want to do that study or do I not? But that's a way for you to know about any study that's going on here that your child would qualify for so that you really know what you could be participating in. And then each point you find out that when somebody gives you that information, you can call in and say, well, what is it involved? It doesn't fit my schedule now. Can I come later? Not this study, but another. So that's a really great way for you to learn about what's going on that you and your child may be able to participate in. Do we have anybody here? Do we have the forms here for families?
Yes, we have the forms, and you also can access it through the website.
Okay, so they're right out front or on the website. You can find this. On the website, you'd look at their Mind Institute, research,
And there, scroll down.
Scroll down, and you'll find the, what's it called on there?
Well, it's just, it's sort of
just
a fill in the blank and email it.
Question here.
Are you taking referrals from your lovely neighbors in Reno, Nevada? Or is this email project?
Yes.
Because I read it's a birth to three center early intervention, and we are doing diagnosing the children under three, but I've had a very difficult time getting children referred here by going through the UC Davis referral line.
Yeah, well, that's a but that's through the clinical assessment piece. If families are willing to come down from Reno for five or six visits and be part of our database and just be contacted when studies come up that they'd be eligible for, there's no restriction on that.
Yeah. Or other studies that don't involve
six
visits.
Right.
One of your recruiting ladies that you introduced as opposed to going through the UC Davis referral line?
Yes.
The UC Davis referral line goes to the clinic. What we're talking about goes to the research.
Okay.
For this purpose, they're completely separate. And there are lots of studies that the people living anywhere can participate in. Doesn't have anything to go with, through the clinic.
Right, absolutely. Way in the back, on the right.
Okay, I'm as a lay person, I do know.
Can you come up to the microphone, please? Yeah, sorry, but I want to make sure that everybody can hear your question.
As a lay person, I do have a son who is autistic. He is 17 years old. And I had a question, I believe, for Dr. Rogers. You were talking about habituation.
Mm-hmm.
Once they adapt to maybe a stressor or something like that, do they then become that way in that situation continually? When they find that comfort zone, is that going to be their reaction continuously?
Oh. Okay, the process, I'll stand up because I'm very
short.
Okay, so the process of habituation is something we all go through all the time. You know, if in your house, if you sleep and the window's open and there's a noise, a dog is barking and you hear it and you notice it, but as you lie there and you're tired, you go to sleep anyway. And if that, like in my neighborhood, there are four dogs, two houses down, and they bark like crazy. And when I first moved there, it was like, how does anybody ever sleep? Now I don't even hear those dogs. I mean, they bark, I sleep, it doesn't disturb anything. I've habituated to it. It's just part of the noise of the house. Doesn't have any meaning for me, and I'm used to it. That's what habituation is. It's just over time, it has less and less meaning. It doesn't arouse your orienting system. It just kind of becomes background. So that's what we're talking about, that people with autism, that curve, that habituation curve, meant the kids were getting used to that loud, loud siren. They were reacting less over time. And yes, I think you would assume that for a person with autism who's getting used to a sound or a touch or something in your house, that over time, as they get used to it, that's a relatively permanent adjustment they're going to make, just like we do, in that setting for that stimulus. Of course, if it changes, gets louder, you change the detergent, they're used to one detergent, you change another, then there's another cycle. I think the only reason it's important to me is I think there's a question for people with autism who are reactive to things. Well, does it mean we need to keep them away from that forever? What's the right way to do it? And I think what this is saying is we should try to work with gradual accommodation. We want children and adults to be in the world with everyone else and to not be separated by their sensory reactions. So we want to try to find baby steps to help them get used to these things. If you're bothered by tags, you maybe start to wear smooth underwear underneath them so that it doesn't bother you. Bother by sounds, you may carry the little earplugs that you get in the airplane. So it's just that idea that we could, we're working for people to get used to environments and for us to help them find ways to find a level at which they can go ahead and function and concentrate without being so disrupted by those triggers for them.
Okay, I have a number of kind of thoughts. I'm the mother of two quirky kids. They both have stereotypic behaviors. My 15-year-old also has some OCD, and you kind of put this through, and I just was listening as I was thinking about him. The interesting thing that I want to get a little bit more information about is comorbidity. I'm a speech-language pathologist, and I have a number of children who are on the spectrum who also have ODD, or have OCD, or have Tourette's, or have epilepsy, and the process that I go through is trying to strain out what is just observational to what is really what research is saying. So I'd appreciate some insight. Thank you.
Well, I'll start, but then Robin's going to join in, I think. So this is a really great question. We're talking about comorbidity means sets of psychiatric symptoms when you're overlapping. So for a child with autism, if they also have depression, then you'd say they're comorbid for autism and depression. Or if they also have a tremendous amount of anxiety, they may be comorbid for anxiety and autism. And as you know, children with autism also have their share of other symptoms, including depression and anxiety and phobias. Some children with autism develop schizophrenia. I mean, a child with autism can have any, or an adult can have any other psychiatric disorder that anybody else can get. And so the question is, to what extent does autism itself blend into these other disorders? And I think as we learn more about and I'm not a psychiatrist, so I'm talking a little bit out of my area here, but I think for us, the way that we carve up psychiatric diagnoses into these discrete categories, it's useful for a classification process, but it's not really how behavior symptoms work. You know, repetitive behavior can turn into a compulsion or a ritual, and there's no line, really, between what's repetitive behavior and what's a ritual. It's a little more of this, a little more of that. So when you think broadly, the symptoms we're talking about occur in a broad range and on a bell-shaped curve, and in autism we're just dissecting a part of it and saying we're going to call it this. So to what extent there are two different conditions in one child versus these disorders kind of all blur together in reality, and where is anybody on any of these spectrums at any time, that's kind of that's what's hard to figure out. And I think what's really important in autism or in mental retardation or in any of the developmental disabilities is that it's easy to over-attribute everything to the one diagnosis. And so lots and lots of children and adults don't get the help they need because we treat autism as if it's everything. You know, they don't sleep at night, oh, it's the autism. They're throwing up, oh, it's the autism. They have diarrhea, oh, it's the autism. Well, this isn't fair because autism's just three things. As David said, it's social, communicative, and repetitive behaviors of a very specific type that co-occur. Anything that's not those three things, that's not the core of autism. That is something else. And that needs to be looked at as if it's completely separate and treated that way to make sure that this is called the overshadowing, that we're not letting this one diagnosis of autism overshadow everything else. And this happens a lot in autism, and it happens a lot in children with intellectual disabilities or mental retardation. We lump everything into this one category. We have to have very discerning eyes, and it's sometimes hard because many children have lots of symptoms. But we want to keep saying, well, if he didn't have autism and he was doing this, what would I do? I'd call the doctor. I'd get a consult. This isn't normal. Well, if it wouldn't be normal for your other children, then it's not going to be normal for your child with autism either. And we want to act as if it's something separate until it's proven otherwise. That's how we can get the best care. Do you want to add to
that? Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right. And I think that just another example that I was going to give is right now the way that the DSM-IV is written is that if you have autism, it sounds like you can't have a diagnosis of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Although we all know that there are some kids with autism who have all the symptoms besides symptoms of autism of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. They're not like other kids with autism who don't have attention, short attentions, distractibility, impulsivity, all that sort of stuff. And so it's becoming much more clear that we have done too much lumping and attributing lots of other symptoms that can be treated with autism and this big overlap. So it's not only true with sort of behaviors, but it's also true with a lot of other medical disorders. And it's partly because it's difficult for children with autism and adults to communicate what's hurting, what's uncomfortable, and so I think we really do need to pay attention to what might these behaviors be telling us about another system besides the brain.
Did you say something, Christine? No. Well, I will just add one last comment to that. That from a research point of view, comorbidities are really important because let's take the example that you gave. If you have seizures plus autism, we know that if you just look at seizures alone, it's going to impact many brain regions. it's going to have neuropathology of certain parts of the brain. So that if you're looking at the brain and you're trying to figure out what really is at the heart of autism, what's going wrong in this brain, and you're looking at an individual that has both autism and seizures, then what you're going to see is some combination of the two. And how can you attribute one to autism and one to epilepsy? And unfortunately, in the past, many of the studies that have been done, even imaging studies, but for example, post-mortem studies that have been looking at the pathology of the brain, have included, I think actually 75% of all the brains that have been looked at to look at the neuropathology of autism have included individuals who during life had autism plus epilepsy. So, you know, the conclusions you draw are, you know, not very reliable. So one of the things that, again, we do in the Autism Phenome Project and what the MIND Institute tries to do is to clarify what's the entire spectrum of symptomatology and then pick individuals. For example, in the MRI studies that Christine was talking about, in the APP, we take all comers. But we've had other studies where we restrict those individuals who have epilepsy so we can just look at the features of autism. So I think it's incredibly important. Anxiety, some studies suggest that anxiety is as much as 84% of individuals with autism also have an anxiety disorder. You know, but it's, again, difficult to diagnose, as you've heard. I think we can take maybe two more questions, and then we'll take one here, and then, yeah, let's take first this one.
Okay. This doesn't really have to do with tonight, but I have a 10-year low-function autistic son. We're in Fallon, Nevada, so this was my chance to ask the question.
Okay, sure.
His behavior is really bad, and he's not able to really learn in school, and it may just be me, but I've always said that until the behavior is under control, he can't learn. And I'm trying to find out about ABA therapy. Is he too old to get help for that?
That's a good question.
Sally will answer yeah. that, yes.
You're never too old for therapy, any of us. And it's always the right time for therapy. Now, applied behavior analysis is a very effective approach to children's learning and behavior problems, children, adults, across the age range and across the functioning level. And children who are older and children who have more severe disabilities respond to treatments very well when the treatments are carried out and very specifically tailored. So that would certainly be an appropriate way to try to tackle his learning needs and his behavior problems. And I'd be very optimistic that with a good therapist and good follow-through and careful functional analysis and excellent consistency in the environment that you should see some positive changes.
That's the problem. We're enrolled in that.
Well, the power of a family is a mighty power, no matter where you live.
Last question back right there. Could you, I'm sorry, but I hate to do this to you, but we want to make sure that everybody hears your question and we get it for posterity on video.
I represent or know of a number of children with autism, including my youngest grandson. In his case, he got a triple whammy. He is a second RH factor child. He needed surgery at 18 months to correct a congenital defect that they waited till the, anyway, but that's when the autism seemed to develop. He had a weak eye, and the glasses they put on him, rather than having additional surgery, interfered with his perception out of his good eye. So that affected his self-esteem and self-confidence. So we're dealing with all these factors, as well as the GI problem. But my husband had that same GI problem without having being diagnosed or even viewed as autistic. But the and as his he has an immediate stress response with his GI, mm-hmm. and it's been 40 years. Mm-hmm. And nobody, he's been tested every which way possible. And there was nothing there. So they thought it was in his mind. I mean, it was like, you know.
Right.
But he was a type A personality. But anyway, our question is, because we have not only one of our own grandchildren, but one of our friends within, you know, that we view as our family circle, And then our next door neighbor came from Utah. And most of her nieces and nephews, of those who were able to have children with these types of problems. That's where the testing was in the 50s. Mm. So those who were children of people who were exposed to nuclear fallout are having serious, in other words, children showing up like this, if they have children at all. But we were concerned, in which they could immediately remove the mercury in relation to the immunization. Why wait for 20 years of studies if there's any risk factor to remove the known risk factors? They've done this repeatedly. It's like smoking. In other words, we'll do some studies, and in 20 years, you know, in relation to our children, that's not an acceptable risk factor.
I'm
not sure about the question, but I guess I'll make a comment about the issue of genetic. I think it was sort of the question of genetic susceptibility and potential environmental triggers, and sort of the mixed information that I think is concerning when it's hard to sort out, particularly information that can be very scientific, but also can be not very well done scientific information. So I think mercury is one of the hardest questions to sort out, and I think there has been a lot of concern. There have been a lot of studies trying to see whether or not there is a correlation between adding mercury to vaccines, taking it out of vaccines. Most of the childhood vaccines, other than the flu vaccine right now, do not have mercury in them and haven't for several years now. And that in and of itself doesn't seem to have changed the prevalence of autism. It seems to keep going up despite having removed the vaccines. And I guess it comes back to this question: when you look at really well-done large epidemiologic studies and you don't find a correlation between vaccinations and mercury or no mercury or the number of vaccinations or when the vaccinations were given, and you don't find a correlation, which no one really has, in large epidemiologic studies, it still doesn't answer the question, well, if we have subtypes of autism and there are different causes for different kinds of autism, it may be that there are children who are genetically susceptible to heavy metal exposure or to live attenuated vaccine viruses that we are missing when we do these really large epidemiologic studies. And so that's where we are right now. And it's, you know, I think it's a really hard question for parents who are thinking about vaccines and exposures through food and through air and through water and our world.
Yeah, well, I think you raised the general question of why aren't risk factors removed immediately? And I think part of the problem is really identifying what is a risk or not. I would agree with you that, you know, putting ethyl mercury into a vaccination for, you know, for a child was never a good idea. And you know, now it's been eliminated. But as it's been eliminated, as Robin said, in California, actually the number of cases of autism continue to increase. And now the kids that are being diagnosed are kids that were immunized with vaccines that didn't have the mercury in it. So what the evidence would be is that even in these large epidemiological studies, it wasn't a strong factor, and now that it's been removed, we haven't seen a dramatic change. You know, if it was really the culprit, you'd expect to have a dramatic change, and that hasn't happened. And I think what's important is, you know, as a parent myself, and I can empathize with trying to find a culprit out in the environment. And what we as scientists have to do is figure out what's the most likely culprit and then invest our resources into that. Because every time you pick a new thing, whether it's mercury or, you know, or vaccine or this or that, it's enormously costly to try and figure out whether that's really what's causing autism or not. So what we spend a huge amount of time is trying to make our best guess at what may be a culprit and what's not. The fact that we have Dr. Vandewater and Paul Ashwood, immunologists, we're actually very, and as she said, there's now strong evidence that the immune system is playing a role. And I think it makes a lot of sense to figure out, generally speaking, how is the immune system possibly involved in the etiology of at least some cases with autism. But again, listen to what Judy was saying. You know, it's 21% of the mothers have the autoantibodies, 46% of the kids have the autoantibodies. It's never 100%. And what we really need to do is figure out who are those susceptible kids. So you raise an important issue. You know, when I think about this, it really frightens me because think about what's changed over the last 30 years. I was flying on a plane to Atlanta drinking my Diet Coke, and I said, you know, it could be Diet Coke. And the guy sitting next to me was the Coke executive. And he said, no, it can't be Coke. But, you know, enormous number of things have changed over the last 30 years. And it's sort of a daunting task to figure out where do we put our resources, our science, and our effort. But you can be assured that not only here at the Mind Institute, but scientists are taking this very seriously. And if anything, I think that the idea that the environment might be a contributing factor has gone from 10 years ago, people not paying attention to it whatsoever, to at the most recent international meeting for autism research, the director of the National Institute of Mental Health said, we need to really spend more time investigating environmental contributions. So it's being taken seriously now at the highest level. I think probably we've kept you here long enough. So thanks so much for coming tonight.